cross, amen? I want you to ignore the yellow jacket flying around. That is the property of Oaks Drive Baptist Church. If you harm that, you will probably get a hamburger after. We have to make this. Every year at this time, we get one or two of these things, and I'm fixing to, if it comes my way, we'll end its life. But it's crazy. This is what we deal with distractions. But I want you to focus this morning on the Word of God. I want you to focus on the real Christmas message. And I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, we are looking at verses 1 through 8, really preaching part 2 of a message that I preached last week, and that is about the return of Christ. If I had to put a title on this message today, it is this: what happens, not if Jesus returns, but what happens when Jesus returns? And how many of you know it's not a matter of if, it's only a matter of when He comes back, right? And in Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, this is kind of what we call a prologue of a book. If you've ever read a book, and I know that you have, if you've looked at inside the table of contents, or you've seen a description, a brief summary of what that book is about, you will kind of get an idea of where that the author is headed. And in Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, this is a prologue. This is telling us a preview of what is to come. But listen, this is so important because Christ is coming back one day. And we've said this so many times. Please do not think that another prophetic event has to be fulfilled or some other political event has to take place for Christ to come. The return of Jesus Christ is not dependent on anything that humans do. It is dependent on His own prophetic calendar. There is an author named Dan Brown. How many of you ever heard of Dan Brown? He wrote a book and turned into a movie called The Da Vinci Code. One of the most blasphemous, dumbest pieces of literary writing that you could ever read or go see. But Dan Brown just recently came out and said this. You ready? He said that in a few years, human technology is going to replace the idea of a consciousness of God. He said in a few years, technology will supplant the need to have a relationship with God. There is currently a Russian billionaire, and he is working on a project called Russia 2045. He believes that technology then or by then will be able to reprogram us, genetically alter us, that we don't have a need for God. Well, what I want to know with those big dummies is what's going to happen when Jesus returns? Because all their technology and all their book smarts is not going to avail them anything. And when Christ comes back, He's going to set the record straight. Jesus is coming back to take back what is rightfully His, and that is His earth. He's taking off the earth what is rightfully His, those who are redeemed. So it's not a matter if Jesus returns, it's what's going to happen when Jesus returns. And there are prophetic clues that we cannot ignore. But I want to read verses 1 through 8 of Revelation chapter 1. The last couple of years I've used Revelation as a Christmas message. I've used Revelation as an Easter message. I've used Revelation as a Thanksgiving message. I've used it as a just because message. It's just a great book, amen? But in verse 1 of chapter 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ. If you have a Bible that might, an old Bible that might have a study note says the revelation of the Apostle John, I'm going to tell you that's cute, but that's inaccurate. This is the revelation of who?
Jesus Christ.
The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave Him to show His servants things which must shortly take place, and He sent and signified it by His angel to His servant John, who bore witness to the Word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it. For the time is near. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. And he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with clouds, And every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Now, I've just said a mouthful, and I promise you we're going to cover these verses quickly, but I hope effectively, because I'm going to give you a gift this morning. It's not a gift that I bought. It's not a gift that I created. It is the gift of the Word of God that does not come back void, because the goal of the message this morning is to inspire confidence and assurance in your life. You don't have to be concerned about the future. I read recently, or just this morning, it was breaking news, that Kim Jong-un is declaring an act of war against all those who are going to blockade or sanction him. That goofy little man, one day he is going to bow the knee before Jesus Christ. And people say, oh no, he's going to declare an act of war. He's a mean man. Well, you know what? He's mean and he's evil. But he's not bigger than Almighty God. And so the future, you're saying, well, what's going to happen with North Korea? What's going to happen with Iran? What's going to happen with ISIS? I can tell you what's going to happen. God's going to silence them one day. And he's coming back. And there's an assurance and a confidence if you know Christ as Savior. And if you're living in obedient to Christ as Savior, there is a confidence and an inspiration that you should be able to draw out of the Word of God. And the first thing I want to make a point is the certainty of his return. Look in verses 1 and 2. And I hope you have a handout. There's some in the back. If you need one, just quickly go and get one. Don't worry if you have to get up. But if you don't have a Bible, there's also one in the pew. And if there's not one in front of the pew, just look on with your neighbor. Say, hey, thanks for sharing today. And just remove their Bible from their possession and say, I need to look at this more than you do. And so, understand, in verses 1 and 2, the certainty of his return. Not if, but the certainty. Now look at verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, the things which must shortly take place, and he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. Now I want you to see where the source of this message is coming from. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him, and then God gave it to Jesus Christ. Jesus gave it to the angel. So where's the source of the Word of God? It comes from God himself, doesn't it? This speaks of the certainty of his return. And I also want you to see something else. You see in verse 1, and it says, these things which must shortly take place. Now, you may not know the Greek, and that's okay, but the Greek word is entaki, which we get the English word tacos, not the tacos you eat, but tacos, T-A-C-H-O-S. On most vehicles, there is an RPM gauge, and that is, this Greek word tacos means tachometer. What this means is if you accelerate on your car, your RPM gauge is going to go, isn't it? It's going to go to whatever the numbers are on that gauge. And it measures the RPMs, the revolutionary terms of the power of that motor, right? Now you notice when you accelerate, it's going to increase. But when you decelerate, what happens? It stops. Well, once the events of Jesus' return take place, you need to hear this, it's going to go quickly. 7 years will go as fast as that RPM gauge on your vehicle. This is so critically important because we live in a world of procrastination. We live in a world, take it for granted. We live in a world, I got plenty of time. We live in a world, nothing's going to happen to me. And right now, you are going to take your own life in your hands this weekend if you're traveling. Because why? Highways. There's always a potential risk for accident. And there's always some person being selfish and evil who's going to get drunk and drive and either wipe himself out or hurt someone else. This is a dangerous weekend. Although it's supposed to be a celebration of something spiritual, we realize that our life is in peril every day, don't we? Well, once the events of Revelation open up, once Jesus comes back, it's in talking, man. It's just going to go quickly. 7 years are going to go just like that. And if you're here for the 7 years of tribulation, God bless you, because you're going to need lots of it, because you're not going to survive. And here he says the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants. It's going to take place quickly. And this is from the Word of God. We said it last week, we'll say it again. The Bible says it is impossible for God to lie. By two unchangeable truths, God cannot, God will not lie. His word stands forever. This is coming from the source of God Himself to Jesus Christ, to the angel, to His servants. And you'll notice something. That Revelation, you will see, is a prophetic book because it says the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show. That word show is the Greek word apokalypto. And y'all have heard of the word apocalypse, haven't you? You know what it means? To pull back the curtain, to unveil. That's what Revelation is. It's showing Jesus Christ for who He is. He's not the little baby in the manger. He's not just the one that walked on the sea. He's not just the one that raised the dead. This Jesus Christ that Revelation is unveiling is a beautiful, majestic, pictorial description of Jesus Christ, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the great and mighty God. And now the world is going to see Him for who He is. And so in Revelation, it's a prophetic book. It's a pictorial book. Notice in verse 2, John, it says, who bore witness to the Word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all the things that he what? Y'all see that? To all the things that he saw. John is seeing this revelation unfold. And you say, why are you preaching this on Christmas? Because there's a second half to the Christmas message.
Yep.
How many of y'all ever watched The Christmas Story and Ralphie and the BB Gun?
Yes.
Now come on, tell me you have watched that. Lie about it, even if you haven't. I mean, you're un-American if you haven't watched it. But do you remember? Ralphie thought he got everything that he was going to get that Christmas morning. And y'all remember what happened? He wanted a Red Ryder BB gun, didn't he? And by the way, it starts at about 3 o'clock today if you've never seen it for 24 hours. And his dad asked Ralphie, did you get everything that you wanted? He said, well, almost. And his dad says, well, that's the way it goes. And he says, wait a minute, what is that over there? There was another gift yet to still be unopened. Y'all remember what that gift was, don't you? It's the BB gun. Well, folks, forget any kind of a gift that you could compare this to. There's a second half to the Christmas message. Jesus is coming back, but He's not coming back as a baby. He's not coming back as a Savior. He's coming back as Judge. He's coming back as the King. He's going to show the world who He is once and for all. That's why the Bible says there is no other way to heaven but Jesus Christ. That's why we don't pray to anyone but Jesus Christ. That's why it is Jesus who died on a cross. That's why the choir sang, it's all about the cross. It really is all about the cross. It really is all about His resurrection. It really is all about His return. So there's the certainty of His return. John saw this to the testimony of Jesus Christ, of all the things that he saw. The second thing I want you to look at is the comfort of His return. Because as a Christian, I'm pretty comfortable. In fact, I'm more than comfortable. If Jesus came back tonight, I'm ready to meet Him. Now, am I perfect? No. Do I have some things I want to get right? Absolutely. But I'm telling you, I know when Jesus Christ comes, I'm not missing that great appearance. When He comes to take me off the earth, that's it. But this is not talking about removing Christians. This is about coming back to the earth. And by the way, 7 years is not a very long time when you consider all the hellacious, catastrophic upheaval that's going to take place. So there is a comfort, though, in His return. If you are a Christian, you need to realize something, that you should be comforted knowing that He's coming back one day.
Yes.
That you won't be here for this tribulation, but that He is coming back to get you. But there should be a celebration. There should be something comforting, we should say, in verse 3. Look at this. Blessed. Y'all see that word blessed? That means to be at peace. That means to have confidence. That means to be perfectly content, free from external circumstances. It's hard to be at peace if you're under financial stress, isn't it? It's hard to be at peace if you're in physical dire straits. Sometimes it's hard to be at peace if you know your family's falling apart. It's hard for a parent or a grandparent to be at peace if they know their children or grandchildren are making bad decisions, dangerous decisions, and rebellious decisions. It's hard to be at peace if you know that you don't know if you're going to have a job in the next couple of weeks. It's hard to be at peace when you're waiting on the call from a doctor, isn't it? But I want to tell you, John says there is a comfort in his return. Blessed is he. And here's why this is so important. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is at near. Now you need to understand, reading, hearing, and keeping, that means it's more than an academic approach to the Word of God. Reading, keeping, reading, hearing, and keeping means I'm not only going to read it, I'm going to receive it, I'm going to believe what the Word of God says, but I'm not only going to believe it, I'm going to obey it. Right? And you notice something about verse 3, there's a comfort because this is all present tense. This is all present tense. That means you've got to keep doing these things over and over and over on a daily basis if you want to have comfort in Jesus Christ. Now, it's one thing to receive Him as Savior, but it's a whole other thing to follow Him and live for Him. And the only way you're going to have comfort in this world is to follow Jesus Christ, is to do what He says. Communicate with Him, pray to Him, worship Him. Do what the Bible says. I do not find in any 66 books of the Bible where it's okay to say, okay, I can be a Christian and I can still sin. I can be a Christian and I can still lust. I can be a Christian and I can still lie. I can be a Christian and still. I can be a Christian and murder because God's forgiven me. I've got fire insurance. That's not what the Bible says. If you follow the light of the world, you're going to walk in the light. 1 John says, if he is in the light, which he is, and you are in the light, which you say that you are, you need to walk in obedience, because those who say they walk in the light and do not his will, they deceive themselves and they make God to be a liar about his word. And God doesn't lie. So it means the problem is with you. But these things are important in the comfort. Now you'll notice blessed. It means to be free from external circumstances. How many of you have ever read the Beatitudes of Matthew 5? Y'all remember that? Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. He says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall what? Inherit the earth. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be what? Comforted. Blessed are they who hunger, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the pure in God heart, for they shall see God. Why are the Beatitudes so important? Because it describes a way to have a right relationship with God. And it has nothing to do with being poverty without money. It has nothing to do with being physically hungry. It's all about spiritual positioning before God. Be humble when you come before God. Now watch this. He says, blessed are those who read, keep, and hear those things. This is much like the Beatitudes. And in the book of Revelation, you will find some Beatitudes. Quickly turn to Revelation 14 if you would. I think our computer is working. Okay, it's on the screen. Revelation 14, verse 13. Then I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, miserable are the dead who die in the Lord. Is that what it says? I want to make sure you're paying attention. You're going to get out of here by noon so you can get on with your celebrations. But I want to make sure you're seeing this. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, let them rest from their labors, for their works follow them. Y'all see that? That's a beatitude of Revelation. Blessed are those who die in the Lord. You mean loved ones that have died that know Jesus Christ? You mean I'm going to see them again? Absolutely. You mean they're perfect right now? Absolutely. You mean it is a blessing to die? If you're in Christ, it is a blessing to die in Christ, because the hope and the assurance of eternity is there for the taking. And if you don't know Christ, it's miserable. You will be miserable. You will die and you will go to hell. But blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Show the next one, Mary, if you would. Revelation 16, verse 15. Look, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who is alert and remains clothed, so that he may not go naked and they see his shame. You know what he's talking about? Blessedness? Preparing to meet Christ. Nakedness refers to a shame. It refers to being caught spiritually exposed in your sin. Blessed is he who is alert, who is vigilant, who is ready for his return. Remember, the Bible says they should love his appearing. Show the last one if you would. We just went over this a few weeks ago. Then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage feast of the Lamb. He also said to me, these words of God are what? True. So these blessings, these beatitudes are very, very important here, because it's describing the relationship we can have with God. Now watch this. That's the comfort of his coming. But you'll notice there's something else very, very important about verse 3. For the time is near. That's not an event on the calendar. That's not your watch. For the time is near. That means it's a certain season, a period of time that's going to happen, regardless of what I said earlier, of what men do. Now, there's something else very important. Look at verse 4. Now you're going to see the celebration of his return. John to the seven churches which are in Asia. First thing I want you to be aware of, especially if you're listening to social media, if you've never seen this passage, even here in the church. The seven churches, seven describes what? The number of completion or perfection. But these seven churches in Asia do not just refer to those churches that were historically a church at one time or another. This refers to all seven churches, seven church periods, all at one time. What this means in verse 4 is the seven churches. Remember, there was the compromising church. There was the dead church. There was the church that was persecuted. There was the loveless church. There was the church that had literally endured all the persecution that it possibly could, the Smyrna church. But these seven churches represent attitudes and ages even today. Seven is the number of completion. Now watch what happens. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. And this talks about his eternity, past, present, and future. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne. Now, why these seven spirits? When you get to heaven, you're going to see seven spirits? That would freak me out. We don't have a seven-headed God. What is the seven spirits referring to? Seven is the number of what? Completion and perfection. Seven refers here to the Holy Spirit. And God the Father, come on, say it with me, the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God who? The Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit is as much God as Jesus is, right? And the Holy Spirit has perfect knowledge, just like Jesus does, just like God the Father does. And notice it says that the seven spirits literally describe the fullness of God before the throne. And from Jesus Christ, verse 5 says, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead. And the faithful witness is a Greek word that you've heard. It's martyria, and it means martyr. Now, you know what a martyr is? A martyr is one who is willing to die for truth. I'm not talking about a martyr like those goofballs ISIS or those demonically led Islamic terrorists. That's not what I'm talking about. But I'm talking about a martyr who is willing to die for the truth of God. Jesus was willing to die for preaching, living, and speaking and writing the truth, wasn't he? He didn't care about his own life. He died for us. And remember what I said last week. Jesus did not have to come to this earth. He did not have to die on a cross. Jesus did not have to come and redeem us. We could have all died in our own sins, but he came because he loved us. But he's a faithful martyr, a witness, the firstborn from the dead. That means he literally was the first and only one who's ever risen from the dead, who died under his own power, who rose from the grave under his own power. And to him who loved us, verse 5 says, and washed us from our sins in his own blood. I need to tell you, if you haven't heard anything, hear this. Who washed us from our own sin, or washed us from our sins in his own blood. Folks, this is a personal sacrifice, what Jesus did for us. And I want you to see why this is important. I've given you a scripture in the handout. Quickly read along as I read this scripture. It's found in 1 Peter 1, 3 through 9 and 1 Peter 1, 18 through 20. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. Verse 5 says, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found, your faith that is, to praise, honor, and glory at, look, the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And then lastly, that 1 Peter 1:18 through 20. Knowing that you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Now that's a lot of scripture, but you understand that it is Christ who loosed us from the power of sin and the penalty of sin. It is Christ who washed us in his own blood. And this goes back to that perfection, that seven, that cleansing that Christ gives us. Seven is the number of completion. The blood of Christ is the only source of cleansing that we can find for our sins. I want you to think just for a moment. Going back, when you say, Jesus saved me, Jesus cleansed me, Jesus forgave me, why did he do it? Did he do it based on your looks? How many of you are going to go to heaven because of your looks? If you think you are, you need to see me after the service, because that's the sin of imagination right there, okay? How many of you think you're going to go to heaven because of your money? How many of you think you're going to go to heaven because your spouse thinks you're the best spouse ever? How many think you're going to go to heaven because of your political affiliation? How many think that you're going to go to heaven because you're a Baptist, a Methodist, a Catholic, a Presbyterian, or something like that? You're only going to go to heaven because of what Jesus Christ did for you. And you personally receive that cleansing forgiveness that he offers. It can't just be, well, I believe it and that's enough. The Bible says you've got to receive it. You've got to call upon the name of the Lord. So this is very, very important to understand the celebration of his return. And I want you to see why this is important. Look at verse 6. He has made us kings and priests to his God and Father to him and Father. He's made us priests to his God and Father. To him be glory forever and ever, dominion forever and ever. Amen. In verse 6. Let me tell you what that means. And I know many of you know this and you've heard this recently. Especially if you're listening on Facebook. Wouldn't you become a Christian? When you receive Christ as Savior, when the Holy Spirit convicts you, and in that still small voice, and that conscience bothers you, disturbs you, and says you need to receive Him, let me tell you what's going to happen. Your name is going to be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Your name is going to be written down in God's incredible providential power, and nothing or no one can take that name out of that Book of Life. Amen? Let me tell you what else is going to happen. Now the angels are going to rejoice. But when you become a Christian, you have access to God. Even if you're sitting in the middle of 635 because people were putting their makeup on and caused a fender bender and a backup for 91 miles, you are going to have access to God even if you're lying in a hospital and the doctor's just giving you the worst news possible. As a Christian son or daughter, you have the right to go to the very throne room of God and call upon Him. Amen? Friday, I got an email. That computer back there, it's about to go to Microsoft glory, I'm going to tell you. It's about done. We ordered a powerful computer. It's coming. Somewhere, it's lost. Now, it was going to be delivered Friday. I sat down here all day Friday waiting for it. Watched the rain came down, come down and come down. Went, left, got something to eat, came back. Still not here. Finally got a message from FedEx. And I hope they're listening to this by Facebook today. Got a message, said this is the wrong address. I wrote back, y'all deliver here all the time. This is the right address. Then they called and said, Dell has canceled the order. They're calling the computer back. I called Dell. No, we sent it to 2805 Oaks Drive. Then I got on a chat, a live chat with somebody from FedEx. It says, you are in Q85. And in about 5 minutes, I was in number 69. And then another 20 minutes, I got down to 32. This happened, I kid you not. I'm glad nobody else was in the building because they could hear me yelling all the way over at the Methodist Church. And finally, about 40 minutes later, I was in Q12. Finally, about an hour later, I was queue number one. Only to hear those words or see those words. Your chat session has ended. You have been disconnected. I got back on their phone with FedEx. Now, in my head, I'm thinking, I know why Castaway was filmed, because FedEx is incompetent at this point. I got back, I was Q65. I got down to 63. I got down to Q57. And then those words came on, you are connected to a live representative. How may I help you? He said, well, you will need to contact Dell. They are the ones who rescinded the order. No, they are not. Thank you. Have a great weekend. Oh, by this time, smoke's coming out of my ears. Smoke's coming out of my nose. I'm going to go to the fire department because my blood pressure is 900 over 850 at this point. And you know what I kept thinking all this time? How can such incompetence? I got on the phone with Dell. What they offered me is a 10% discount to come out here and hook up the computer. I said, I don't have a computer. Oh, that is a problem. I said, are you serious? At this point, I am just livid. And I said, you people are incompetent. Hang on just a second. Nope, I don't see any deacons or staff here. I can't believe you people are doing this right here. Finally, I got an answer. The answer is, we'll get back to you in 24 hours. Still haven't heard from them. But I got an automated generation response. Thank you for contacting Dell. Thank you for calling FedEx. Then they said, please review your call with FedEx. I'm still reviewing. I haven't sent them. I'm on page 85. Now, aren't you glad when it comes to going to the throne room of God, the Holy of Holies, you can go there without any interference?
Amen.
Now, we know we deal with this all the time. You've heard it. Please listen closely as our menu options have changed. Y'all know what I'm talking about, don't you?
Yes.
Folks, with Christ, you go to the throne. You've been made accessible. You've been given access to Him. It's a celebration of His return. But then I want you to see something else. This is very, very important. There is a crisis in His return as well. Look at verse 7. Behold, He is coming with clouds, and every eye will see Him. Now, I want to tell you about the clouds. That is part of a celebration. That's also a part of a horrible time for those who've been left behind, those who have rejected Christ, those who are just religious but not redeemed. Because you will notice, behold, He is coming. That's present tense too. That means He's on His way right now. Did y'all know that? That means in God's mind, He's already returned. And what that means is He's already got the date set. And I know there's people who try to put dates on it because they want to sell a book or a tape. No man knows the hour in which Jesus returns. But behold, He is coming with clouds. Now, clouds have always been associated in the Bible with God in a negative sense and a positive sense. Do you remember when God gave the law off Mount Sinai? Do y'all remember? There was a thick clouds and lightning and earthquake and rumblings upon that mountain. But you remember God also guided the Israelites, fire by night and how by day? A cloud. And that cloud contained His presence. That was the Shekinah glory, the presence of God. But it's this cloud that when Jesus comes back, it's going to darken the whole earth. Because we know the earth is going to be turned upside down. Now watch this. Behold, He is coming with clouds, and every eye will see Him. Now, is that going to be dependent on technology? How are people in Texas going to see Christ if He goes in the Middle East? How are people in Europe going to see Him if He goes and turns in Hawaii? He doesn't need technology to make His presence known. He doesn't need Skype. He doesn't need a drone. When He comes back, the entire world is going to see Him. And they who pierced Him will see Him. Why is this important? Because those who pierced Him is not just referring to Jews, unbelieving Jews, although it is. It's not just referring to the Roman soldiers, but it's referring to anyone who's ever rejected Christ. And you need to understand, it's happening. Christ is ready to come back. He said, why hasn't He come? By grace and mercy, He's held off so far. But remember in 2 Peter 3, we learned that the scoffer, the critic, the doubter, the one who laughs, the one who mocks, says, I got lots of time. Things are always as they are. They're not always as they are. Do you know that the United Nations just passed a condemning resolution against the United States because the president recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, which it is? The UN can pass resolutions all day long, and Jerusalem is still the capital of Israel. The UN can say, hey, we are not going to stand for that. This is why, again, I wish and I pray to Almighty God, get the United Nations out of our business. We don't need them. We don't want them. They're useless. And these preachers that are out there, again, I said it last week and I want to say it again. Anyone that tells you that the church has replaced Israel, if your pastor is telling you that, you need to get out of that church, because Israel has still got a promise and a covenant with Almighty God, and so does the church of Jesus Christ. And I love it. I don't care whether you like Trump or you hate Trump. I love what he did with the recognition of Jerusalem. He's just fulfilling God's prophecy, whether people want to admit it or not. A German shepherd could have declared it. It's still going to happen, folks. But the bottom line is, he is coming and every eye is going to see him. If you are not a Christian, you will see Jesus again. I watched just with utter disdain Bill Maher, a talk show host, just blast Christians, just make fun of Christianity, make fun of Jesus Christ. I've watched political parties blaspheme the name of Jesus Christ. And they can say they're going to get his name out of the schools and they're going to change these laws, but I'm going to tell you something. Jesus Christ will come back and they will bow the knee. And they're going to be in total horror at what they see. He is coming back again. That first trip he came was to redeem mankind. This next trip is to glorify himself as who he really is. Look at verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who was and who is to come. And there's that outline that you could build revelation. Christ has always been, Christ always is, and Christ will always be. Amen. And he's coming back, and Alpha and Omega, first and the last. He says, I'm in charge. Nothing's going to happen without me. Nothing's going to happen without my knowledge. And when I come back, I'm going to show you, I am the King of all the kings. I am exalted over all the world. Isn't it amazing how these people declare themselves kings? King Abdullah. Well, there's been lots of kings. There's these kings in the Middle East. Uganda, one time, they had a guy named Idi Amin declared himself not only a dictator, but he says he's a king. One, you know, people gave Elvis Presley the title, the king. And he really did tell somebody in a concert. He said there's only one king and it's Jesus Christ. And you know, there's a lot of people who say, oh, he's king. There's a basketball player named LeBron James. They call him King James. There's all kinds of people who say they are king because of their money or their prestige. But I'm going to tell you, there's only one king and his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. Years ago, many years ago, Scott Wesley Brown wrote this song. I'm not going to read the whole song, and I'm sure not going to sing it. That would be a good time for you to say amen. But listen, Scott West, I wasn't being literal there. Literally, listen to these lyrics. Who would have thought that long ago, so very far away, a little child would be born and in a manger lay? And who would have thought this little child was born the King of Kings, the son of just a carpenter, but for whom the angels sing? And who would have thought that as he grew and with other children played, this child with whom they laughed and sang would die for them someday? And who would have thought this little child could make a blind man see, feed the hungry, make rich the poor, and set the sinner free? And who would have thought this little child was who the prophet said would take away the sins of man and rise up from the dead? Then he closes it out with this last couple of verses. Many years have come and gone, yet this world remains the same. Empires have been built and fallen, but only time has made the change. Nation against nation, brother against brother, men so filled with hatred, killing one another. And over half the world is starving, while a banner of decency is torn, and debating over disarmament, killing children before they're born. And fools who march to win the right to justify their sin. But every nation that has fallen from within. But here it comes. But in the midst of this darkness, there is a hope, a light that burns. This little child, the King of Kings, someday will return. Amen? And that song is so anointed of God, it has been sung and used all over the world in different languages to communicate the heart of the gospel, which is that Jesus Christ came to earth because he loved us. Jesus Christ came to earth to die on a cross because he loved us. But he's coming back to show Satan, to show the non-believers, to show all these who want to worship all these false religions that he is the one true God. Listen, I've seen it. We are so politically correct in this nation. We have made ourselves sissies. We are so politically correct, we have decided that we ourselves should go out of our way to offend anyone, or not offend anyone, but we don't mind offending Christians. Well, I got news for you. You may find the world being politically correct, but it's not biblically correct. And this Jesus who's coming back, he's not coming back to play nice. He's coming back to take back what is his. And there is a scroll the Bible talks about. You know, that number 7 is important. Because there is, in the Bible, there's going to be 7 angels that are going to have 7 seals and 7 vials. And on this scroll, he's going to open up. There's going to be 7 seals that are going to open up. And the first one he opens up, it's going to tell what's going to happen. Then he's going to open up the next one, and it's going to tell what's going to happen. This scroll is going to unfold. And I'm going to tell you who's opening the scroll. It's not the angels. It's Jesus Christ. It is this one that promised Satan in the garden in Genesis 3:15, I'm coming, Satan, and you're going to oppose me, and there's going to be hostility, and I realize you're going to bruise me, and you're going to attack me, but I'm going to crush you, Satan. I'm going to destroy you. I'm going to render you back to hell from which you came, and I am going to literally show the world that I am the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It was just last spring over in several places overseas, where they took a picture, they made a parade to mock Christianity. And they took a girl and they dressed her up like the Virgin Mary. And they went and aborted Jesus on the streets in a mock play. And this fake blood came gushing out of her. And they laughed. And one guy held up a sign and says, "Try this, Jesus." But one preacher stood over this and he read them the entire chapter of Revelation chapter 1. And by the time he was reading, they were throwing things at him. They were laughing at him. They were spitting on him. And he just kept reading and reading and reading. But suddenly some of those who were part of that play started to hear the message of the book of Revelation. They looked at that pastor who was reading this, had spit on him, had other stuff on him. They were even trying to throw urine on him. They were literally trying to disgrace him in every way possible. And despite all that, he kept reading Revelation chapter 1. And it came down to the fact where Jesus said, "I am he. I hold the keys to life and death. I am alive. I was dead, but I am alive forevermore." I want to tell you something, folks. The manger's great. Christmas is great. The lights are great. But there's more to Christmas than just the manger.
Amen.
It's all about the cross. It's all about that glorious resurrection. Present tense. He's coming back. You say, "When, preacher?" I don't put dates on it. That's silly. But I'm going to tell you, all the prophetic clues in the world cannot be ignored. God has clearly uncovered the clues, the truth that we need to know, that Jesus is coming back soon. Somebody said that Trump's actions, the media said that what Trump did is causing wars in the Middle East. Where have they been? Some said that this is going to lead to World War III. It might very well do it, but it was going to happen well before Trump got to be president and declared Jerusalem the capital of Israel. Some say that this is going to create a lot of hardships. Does not matter. Because the bottom line is God is going to do what God wants to do. Because God is always right. All the time. I ask you to stand as heads are bowed and eyes closed. Father, in the name of Jesus today, we pray for this invitation time that's so critically important. So essential to doing business with you. I pray there'll be no distractions. Pray, Father God, that you would do business with your people. In Jesus' name we pray. As heads are bowed and eyes closed, this morning we offer an invitation. Even if you're listening through the computer today, this invitation is literally an extension of what Jesus did, calling people to a public decision. My microphone will be off. I will be down at the front to meet you. But if you've never trusted Christ, I want to tell you today, you may be in a jail cell. You may be in a hospital room. You may be in a spiritual prison. You yourself may be in this audience this morning, hurting, lonely, scared, angry, bitter, full of despair. But I want to tell you, fear not. Jesus Christ is on the throne. He's coming back. He's coming back for His children. He's coming back to reveal to the world just who He is. You want to be ready. You don't want to wait till that day of tribulation. You want to be ready. If you've never trusted Christ, you need to admit that you're a sinner. You need to admit that you're ready to receive Him. You say, Pastor, why are you calling us out to make a public decision? I'm not asking you to become a Baptist today. I'm not asking you to become a member of this church. I'm asking you to become a member of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
To receive Christ as Savior. To learn to follow Him. You want to talk about the most powerful gift ever? Salvation is the gift that keeps on giving for all eternity. Hymn of invitation is sung. I'll meet you at the front right now.